grade, everyone, we have Lindsey Whittle, who is graduating from the fashion department this year, this semester. And she did an installation at Sage Galleries when we went to visit Resource Center. It was very colorful installation. And I, you know, her work spans fashion, installation, performance, and I think will relate to what you're working on now and also for the next assignment. And it's pretty, we're pretty happy to have her. So, Lindsey.
Thank you.
Introduce yourself and tell us about your work.
Yeah, I looked over this, I was telling your instructors, I looked over your syllabus and I would love to take that. I'm really interested in a lot of stuff. So I'm just going to talk about my work and focus on the process a little bit, but this is for you, so if you have any questions or anything, don't hesitate to jump in. Don't be afraid. So yeah, I'm a master's of design processing, and I just wanted to start by showing you my undergrad work. I majored in painting, but I actually made four garments, and my work in general is about change and transformation and interactivity. So I made these garments that had lots of holes and slits, and the wearer could choose how they wanted to wear it and build it around their body. So there's always kind of an element of collaboration. I see my work as a starting point, and then when people wear it, they activate it. So this was just a live performance at an art museum in Cincinnati. And then this was right before I came to grad school. I called this the Joy Monster mascot, and I was just trying to be something positive. I feel like a lot of times when you get solicited on the side of the road, people are, you know, they're asking you for something, and I just wanted to be somebody waving on the side of the road. And it seemed to reach a really broad demographic, which was really nice. And then this is my first project here, and it actually was probably the only thing not wearable that I made. I covered a red line car for a party, and I rode it all the way down, and I tried to celebrate everybody that came on and gave them party hats and stuff. So it was a really interesting experience.
Did you have to get a permit?
I didn't. Sometimes I do, but a lot of times when I know they're going to say no, I'd rather ask for forgiveness than ask for permission. And I try not to do anything destructive so that they don't. There's not any problem. So everything I brought on, I took right back off at the end. So this was a hat that I made for a bench, and then I made two of them, one to explore on the body and one I left on the bench. And you can see these are little pillows that I made so that the people waiting for the bus would have something comfortable to sit on. And it was probably up for 6 weeks or 2 months before the weather just kind of took it down. But, and this, I threw in here because I wanted to show you guys that I feel like you're supposed to make work and then leave it like ghosts in your past. And for me, it's always really important that if I'm still interested in something, that I continue to rework it until it's not interesting anymore. In fact, I'm sure you guys know Nick Cave, he's my advisor, and he always says that all work is a sketch until it starts to have conclusions. So, like, you can see this Joy Monster's coming back in here, because I made these little kind of statues or trophies. But then from here, I'm always thinking, like, what are all the different ways that this can go out and be other things? And so I made these fabric prints based on the processes and images of these little statues, and then I make the blouse here from the fabric print. So it's, I mean, everything I make is like, what would this look like 2D? What would this do as a documentation video? What would this do as like an art video? What would it be as an Illustrator file? So I'm always wondering, like, what are the thousand other ways that this can exist? I put this in because I actually feel like in a lot of ways this piece was like a total failure. I'm really interested in connecting people together, and so these are two different outfits that have a magnet seam in the back, and they can open up and make one garment that two people fit in. And it was really fun, and we really actually did ice skate in this, but I didn't think about, because I use these super strong magnets, and they would like stick to the sewing machine as I would sew, and like we even would stick to cars, like as we would walk by. And it just, and this iridescent fabric was fantastic, but it's this weird like plastic PVC, and when you sew it, it creates this perforated line and just like rips. And so like, there was a lot of things that was like a hot mess about this, but I think ideas will only get me so far. Like, I really have to make things to learn. Like, I can't anticipate everything, so I have to make A and B to get to C, and sometimes A and B are like not great work. In fact, I probably say 80% of my work is mediocre work, but it's worth it to get to the great work. So even though this was like kind of all over the place, like it was still important to get to like the next stuff. So that's a huge part of my process, is like making first and thinking later, like trying not to overthink it. So I was still thinking about this, putting multiple people in an environment, and I started to sew. I'm really interested in using silliness as a starting off point to spread good cheer. So the patterns for this were like sunglasses and word bubbles and dinosaurs and things like that. And I was just really sewing abstractly and letting it come out of this. I didn't have like, because normally with sewing you have like a plan, and you sketch and then you make the patterns and then you make the garment. Whereas I was just kind of letting the garment evolve out of these silly shapes. And so here you can see this is when one person wears it and it has all these pockets in it. And when you pull these things out of the pockets, then up to 5 people can wear it. And then here it was just 2 people wearing it. So another huge part of my process is just constantly researching materials. Like no matter what I'm doing, I could be playing with toys with like my little sisters or something, and I'm thinking like, you know, how did they make this material? What are the other ways that I can use it? Like how could I get this fabricated into something else? And so all while I was making these garments that connect people, I started to sew Velcro because I was interested in connecting people together, and Velcro is a material that connects. So I wanted to let the material also apply to the concept. So this one right here was the first Velcro pieces I ever made, and they kind of function like Legos. Like there are lots of little pieces and you can build them up around the body or in a space. So this is kind of over a year, some different ways that I used the Velcro, and you know, there's random people. Another big part of my practice is just cultivating relationships with anybody and everybody. And when other people ask me, like, hey, I'm doing this thing, could you help me with it? Then I always say yes, because I know the time's going to come when I'm going to say, hey, I'm doing this Velcro performance at the library. Is there any way that you could come and do it with me? So I think that's every class you're in, just really build strong connections with your art community. This I was also kind of working on. I'm always working on like 5 or 6 things at once, and some of them get to a more like finished level that I might show, and then some of them are still kind of at sketch level. But when people say like, hey, I have this opportunity, do you have something you can show, then I can pull out one of these 5 things and be like, yeah, maybe I can bring this to a more finished place for this situation. But so I call these connecting glasses, and multiple people can wear them at once again, but they can also function as sculptures or they can function on the body. And what was super weird, and this happens every time I perform an idea, is all these things happen that I never expect. But this, like I really only get close to people's face, like my fiance, like he's probably the only one that I get this close to his face, whereas this was a peer of mine, and we're like navigating this space super close to each other, and you're just like, I just realized that I never really get that intimate with people I don't know very well. And then it changed how we navigated the space too, because we had to be like, oh, watch out for this column or this table, because a lot of times to wear them, we had to kind of, we're staring at each other and we're all contorted. So it was interesting how it really changed how we interacted with each other and how we interacted in the space. So that was my first year of grad school, and all while I'm doing this, I do these daily projects, as you can see. So this is, for about 10 years leading up to grad school, I did what I would call extreme wear, and I went from wearing costumes to kind of mixing up costumes and thrift store finds and things that I made and face paints, and I would do this every day. And it's kind of my way of sketching, but it's also like a way that I can engage with people on a daily basis. I feel like, I don't know if you guys ever heard that story with Coco Chanel, that she would look in the mirror before she went out and she would take one thing off so that she wouldn't over-accessorize. Because for me, I look in the mirror and if I bust out laughing, that's when I know that I'm ready to go out. Because I feel like the chances are somebody else is going to bust out laughing. And it's usually this really interesting conversation starter. Like people will come up to me and be like, what's going on in here? You know, and so I'll end up talking to people of all different kinds of demographics. You know, people that are homeless feel like they can approach me, and then maybe somebody who works for a business, they'll be like, what's going on in your face? You know, so it's just been a really interesting part of my practice, these daily performances. So this is 10 years before grad school, but I only documented the last 3. And then this was my first semester in grad school, so I wanted to continue with this extreme wear, but I focused on the idea of celebration, because that's sort of what I came in with, is celebrating people using silliness as a starting point to spread good cheer. And then the following semester, I really wanted to narrow the parameters and kind of turn the project on its head, and that's another huge doing and kind of make it uncomfortable and discover something new about it. So I would wear paper every day. I'd make a new construction every day. And I tried newspaper, sandpaper, wrapping paper, watercolor paper, and it was like horrible. it was uncomfortable, and I got paper cuts in really strange places, and I was really loud everywhere I went. I made all this noise. Just getting chastened was like every action became this huge focus because everybody paid attention to it. And I stuck out like crazy. You don't have to worry about people noticing you with paper. And it was weird that by narrowing the parameters, I felt like I actually expanded the project. Like, I learned so much by focusing in. And I kept trying to put conclusions on this project. Like, I decided it was going to be a semester, and that was it, and then I was going to have these conclusions. So the first one I tried to do was I put on as many of them as I could from the semester. This is about half of them. And I took a walk down Michigan Avenue, and I thought I would come across as a little, scary or unapproachable, but everybody was like laughing and high-fiving me, and it really seemed to do the good cheer thing that I was hoping for. But I still wasn't done, so I started to make these 2D collages, and I stamped them. I don't know if you can see right here. And this black stamp says, "Worn by Lindsey Whittle, fall of 2013, I think. And then what pieces were still together, since only me had worn the paper, I decided to put a whole community in them and just see what it was like to bring other people into the paper, because I'm just really interested in bringing people together. And then there's a video of this. I actually asked them to rip it all apart, because I was trying to value the people over the work. And so what was left of this, I continued to make more 2D paper, because I was interested in the shift between 3D and 2D, wearable and not wearable. And then I decided to take all these 2D collages and spread them out on State Street and invited people to walk on them, because I was still just trying to figure out how do I value people over the work. And then I put another stamp on them, if you can see this red stamp, and it says walked on State Street. So then I still wasn't done, even though I had said I was going to be done, and I decided to work with just Tyvek. So the semester before, I was making a new composition every day, and it would completely fall apart, and I would keep staplers in my purse to put it back on. Whereas this Tyvek is like a fabric paper hybrid, and you can sew it, and you can add zippers. And so instead of making a new thing every day, I tried to extend one sentence throughout the whole semester. So I added or subtracted to the same outfit every, or the same paper composition every day. And then this semester, obviously, I think it partly had to do with wearing a coat every day, and it covered up what I was wearing, and I feel like the face is where people meet you. So I'm just working with women's makeup, and it seems to really, it's interesting how by not putting it on my cheeks and my eyes, it's a game changer on how people interact with me. And with the paper, people always said to me, "What are you supposed to be?" And I'm like, "I don't know, what are you supposed to be?" Whereas this semester, people always say, "What are you celebrating?" or "Where are you coming from?" So I think that's interesting. That is my goal, is to celebrate people, but that really wasn't what I was going for when I started this, but it's a happy, happy accident. So. And then I threw these in just to go along with this idea that I'm always working on many things at once, and some of them, like this is really still at sketch phase, because again, I'm interested in like bringing people together. So what happens when you bring a community to a solo ritual, and what happens when you bring silliness to a solo ritual? So I'm doing a lot of videos with brushing your teeth. And these are up on YouTube, and so, I mean, that's probably not something you think of, but I think of these videos as sketches, and I think of what I wear as sketches. So sketching isn't always like pen to paper. Like, this is just sorting through ideas. Like, what is it like when other people are doing this? And then I might continue, I might put them in costumes, I might choreograph them. So, I mean, this is something I'll probably jump into after this. And this is just another one of those things. I've been working on smiling, and I make these smiling videos, and I send them out and ask people to watch them and record themselves, and they send them back, and we go back and forth smiling at each other. So in that garment that I said that I was using silly shapes, and I would just let them build into this garment abstractly, that I felt like the shapes were really getting lost. They didn't have a voice because the garment was so organic. And so I was still interested in this idea of connecting things together, so I decided to get those shapes cut from plexiglass with these slits so that they could interlock and build around the body. So this is foam and plexi because I wanted to have a couple of different layers of different materials. And this was at Union Station, and I did get permission for this one because you can't just show up at Union Station. They will kick you out. And then then, again, with this interest of bringing multiple people into one garment, I decided to make a giant choir robe and put a choir inside. And this was at the library down the street, the main library. And they hated, they started out inside, completely inside, as you can see right here. And I wanted them to kind of start out as a sculpture and then evolve into movement and sound and choreography. And they were fantastic. They actually chose me. I put this ad out on Gigmasters, and it was like the most ridiculous request, like looking for this open-minded choir to be silly. And I was like, nobody's going to write me back. And these ladies were like, please pick us, please. And I was like, no. And so I was really just blown away by how these, I had tons of pictures of these. I just felt like they looked like paintings almost. Like I loved how this, and people kept telling me that these compositions looked a lot like flags, which I thought was interesting because, you know, that brings up cultures and people, which is always what my work's about. So I decided to turn these images into 2D flag illustrator files, and that's what they look like here. And I thought it was interesting that now they kind of look like countries, and that was just something that happened. And these I actually ended up using in the stage, the window exhibition. I printed them onto window cling sheets. And these two were opaque and these two were translucent because I wanted to have a factor on the outside of the window that people could engage with, and the window planes, they stick with static, and because that was just a material that I was researching on the side. And so it's interesting how like my work kind of goes forwards and backwards a lot. Like I always kind of pull from old things and get shapes and things from old things. And this was something I was just kind of working on the side. This was one of my paper shapes that I made from, it was out of paper, and it seemed to really have a positive impact. Like everybody that saw me that day would bust out laughing. So I was like, well, what is this like out of a harder material, like wood? And so I'm always wondering, like with those connecting glasses, like how can I bring this to the body? Even if it's not normally worn, like how can I bring this to the body? How can I wear it? So I just walked around Chicago, trying different ways to put it on. I had it on my shoulder, I put it around my leg, and I was, you know, ridiculous kind of waddling with it. And this is still in sketch phase, but I thought it ended up bringing some interesting shots. That's something that also that's a huge part of my practice, is I will like save money to pay for professional photographers to shoot my work. And sometimes if I can't afford it, I'll go in with some of my friends. I'll say, hey, can we all chip in $30 and pay for this photographer and each get 10 minutes or something, because the high quality photographs come back to help me time and time again from my website or online things, things like that. So then I had to decide how do I start to bring some of this stuff that's more finished into kind of a conclusion place for this window. And so I decided to work with the plexiglass and the Velcro and the window planes. And I don't know if you can see this green shape right here behind it. That's the wood shape you just saw. That's this. I ended up upholstering it and putting it in the window because I was still really excited about that shape. So again, this work kind of goes forward to backward. But so I had a year's worth of Velcro that I've been working on, and I decided to write to the company, and I just said, you know, I've been using your brand and your product for a year, and it really positively affects people, and I have these two exhibitions coming up. Is there any way you could sponsor me with materials? And they were really positive, and they did actually send these shapes back here. They're wood that I upholstered with a material called Veltex that they sent me, and it's what they use at conventions, and Velcro will stick to it. So I was able to put my resources into the plexi and the window planes because I reached out to this company to sponsor the rest of it. And this is me inside of here. This was the first performance that I did. Yeah. So every day, so up until this point, every person that I brought into my work, I had been directing them in some way. Like, I want this effect, or I was trying to achieve something with this person. Whereas, I really just wanted to see what happened when I put my work in other people's hands, like what would come from it. So I invited 10 people to perform. There were 12 performances total, because I did the first one and the last one. I wanted to see if my work changed at all between these two performances. And it was really scary, you know, because there's a lot of trust. You have to trust the people that you're working with, that they won't break your materials, that they'll show up, that they, I don't know, that there won't be any negative effects. So it was interesting how this case really became like the room of requirement in Harry Potter. It just completely transformed for each person. So I'm just going to kind of quickly run through all these. There's a ton of them, but the title was also in flux because I just really like things to constantly be changing. So each performer would pick a couple of words that they felt like described their day, and almost everybody had the word transformation except for two. So this was the inside. So this is me the first day. I had my fiance pulling Velcro out of the case and handing them to people watching, and they would build it up around me while I would change the window panes. And then the second day, Sandra Adams, who teaches fashion history here, she wanted to react to the color, so she came in wearing black, and she made paintings reacting to the color of the space, and then she left wearing color. This is the third day, I put a family in there because I wanted to see what would happen if a child was interacting with the work. And it was interesting how it almost instantly went from art space to play space, like within seconds. So, this person worked with sound, so he put microphones inside the case and speakers on the outside and magnified the sound of the Velcro and his footsteps and the flexi. And then I started to pay attention to like the sounds of the elevator and doors and things because he brought attention to that. This is Jake Bowes. He's a performance artist at SASC. He does these things called Trend Camp that focus on celebrity and setting up environments. And he actually made this tent out of the Veltex, and then the Velcro actually just destroyed it. It ate it and spit it back out while he was performing. So. The performer's actually right here. He asked everybody that was watching to come inside the case, and then he would talk to us from the outside about ideas of performer versus audience and the roles that we play, and we had kind of a serious dialogue about how we view art, so it was really interesting. This was a group of sisters, and this artist right here, Marissa Chote, she's a colleague and classmate of mine, and she also does work on connecting people, so I wanted to see how our work could align. So she made these harnesses, and they tried to color coordinate and organize the space together while being tied together. This is a SAIC undergrad named Eutane. She invited people to tell her secret, and she would keep the secret, and she asked that everybody that came through the space would pick an object that they related to and cover her with it when they told her the secret. So by the end, she was completely covered, and you could kind of see the visual weight of what she was now carrying. And I was really surprised at how many people went in there and told her a secret. Like, I was kind of like, because, you know, how do you know she's not going to tell your secret? You can't really guarantee that. This day I brought in some circus performers, and they really kind of tried to do a lot of the routines they would do, but they did it with the work in the space. Again, this some crazy awesome shots. This artist wanted to work with the lighting in the space, and this was really fun because I'd actually never tried that before. So he lit things from behind and underneath. I mean, I hadn't, at this extent, I hadn't tried it before. He had color lights, he had Christmas lights, and we actually left. I would leave the case at the end of the day how the performer left it, so even like the day the child was in there, it was like really messy. The auteur came by and they were like, well, this was really organized yesterday, you know, like, so it was really funny how the remnants of the performance, how people reacted to it. So this, I left the case completely dark all day in the hallway, completely dark all day. This artist came from Ohio, where I'm from. We went to undergrad together, and she would set up compositions in the space, photograph them, and then include the photographs in the installation while she kind of interacted with the pieces. This dress was a knit dress, which the Velcro sticks to, and so she did that intentionally so she could kind of get tangled into the Velcro. And then this was me again, and I put food tables in the case. I put cake and fruit in there and invited the viewers to go in. And what's weird about this case is it's a window, but it feels like a separate room. So I wasn't sure if they would actually watch the performance or if they would just kind of mingle in the case. But so I worked with the plexi on the outside, the plexi and the window plane, so built in composition on the outside while people were going inside and eating cake. And this is just to show you that every night we completely reset the case, my fiance and I, for, because each performer had such different requests. So, you know, like, this one's kind of a twisted motion, and there's a couple of circles. So every day, when people got off the elevator, it's also different. And then this is just another example of, like, what would this be like, painting or 2D? Because this image, like, blows my mind. And then this is just the plexi as a sculpture. That's it. If you guys have any questions, I can show, I have videos of all of this stuff, so if anything you wanted to see, I can put that on.
This is pretty amazing. Yes, it's one of the videos.
Does anybody have a preference of what they want to see? The choir was pretty fun.
Yeah. that whatever you want to share?
Oh, gosh.
Or choosing a color palette, or the more intentional side of that?
Yeah, I mean, I think a lot of it is very intuitive, but I think it's also just kind of trial and error. I mean, especially with the Velcro, like I can kind of lay them on top of each other before I, so I'm just kind of making choices in the moment. Like, oh, this might look good together. This dark color might pop against this bright color. This might make it look outlined. I think the specifics, but I mean, I do, so for every like five colors that I buy that I love, like that neon yellow or all those neon colors, like I'll buy a couple of like a deep wine color or something. I'll try to throw in a couple of colors that I might not always be drawn to kind of balance it a little. Grays, there's a couple of grays in the Velcro. Oh, here, this piece for the first time. But yeah, see like this gray here. White, I mean white's not even a color, I'm going with brown. So I try to throw in some colors that are maybe not my usual aesthetic to try to balance it some. Yeah, I mean this part is kind of making the Velcro and such is kind of the fun part for me. It's almost as if a painter was to go, because the Velcro is a very organic process. I kind of sew, I make decisions in the moment based on what I find visually attractive. So if someone was to have like a palette of paint, go to a painting, like I have like piles of Velcro and I'm just kind of picking what I think will pop where or create, you know, because sometimes they create these illusions, like with this red strip is kind of crazy. With the plexi, I mean, that's laser cut, so I had to order that. So I had to be very, I would just make a couple of Illustrator files of the shapes and I would try different colors and see what I thought worked together as a body of work. And then I actually had it cut twice. The first time was at the Union stagehand, and then the second time was for the window, and I added new colors. So I added the mirror pieces when I got them in, because I thought that that would be crazy. Yeah, so like this girl right here, that's a mirror. There's about five or six, here's a mirror right here. Because I was really interested in the reflection happening. But with this and with the window things, because I'm interested in layer, I tried to do translucent and opaque so that new colors would be made by putting these together. So, did I answer your question?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
What was your experience like being a student in the fashion department, but making garments that aren't necessarily designed for the context of the book?
The grad department's really different than the undergrad department. Like, that's kind of, we're more encouraged to explore the conceptual background behind what we make. Like a lot of the first years this year are making garments, but a lot of the second years are making more installation type work. But I mean, like that blouse that I showed you, a lot of exploring the conceptual work only informs the garments. So there's kind of a give and take, because I mean, maybe that's something that I explore next year, is like, how do I take all this information that I learned from all this research and materials exploration, and how do I turn that into making practical garments or practical moments, at least because I'm not very practical. Did that answer your
question? I think that was really great. The process is fantastic. It seems like you're producing a lot of work at a daily basis. And it seems like this is something that you attach yourself to. Is that how you get from like your work? I know that it's very fluid from one to the other, and it seems like it's
I don't feel like this is very fluid. I can see like where I'm like, oh, this could be. Yeah, I think everything I try to think like, how can I outdo myself or how can I make this? So like, I've been working with this Velcro for a year, but when it came to these exhibitions, it's like, how can I make this more professional? How can I bring it to a new level? How can I completely turn this on its head and have a different experience with it than I've had before? And so I try to say yes to everything, like when people ask me things, because if I don't know how to do it, I can learn how. It's building connections, it's building a network, and I'm learning new things. I mean, obviously you can't overextend yourself, you have to say no sometimes, but I try to say yes to as much as I can. So if somebody says like, hey, I've got this show or something, could you put something in? And maybe I could take the Velcro and try it in a different way, or any of these pieces, the paper, or so that I have all these things going in different directions, but I try to think like, what can I do with this differently in this situation that I haven't done before? So it's like the same work, but in different ways. So it's able to, it's kind of working with what you have, you know, because I wouldn't be able to produce something at a high level if I just busted something out really fast, but if I rework something that's already in my language and try to bring something new to it, then I can learn from it and I can still make that into something that's my quality. Did that kind of answer?
Yeah.
Okay.
Any other questions? Thank you so much for coming.
Thank you for having me. Seriously, these class sounds amazing. That research list of the artists to look at, like those are all my favorite artists. Like,
they all did research of artists and presented them.
Oh, okay. Yeah, that whole list. Hisei Miyake, Urban Worm, and Big Cave, my teacher. Like all of those people like are on my list that I research all the time. So.
And I also wanted to mention that you'll be able to see Lindsey's work in the June show. I think it's going to be June 9th. I don't know. But if you are here in June, she's going to do a performance in the workbook featured in the MFA design show.
Mm-hmm. That's the end.